Okay, Michael, so we've gotten through that quiz, and you see that Bayes' rule actually gives you some information. It actually helps you make a decision. So I'm going to suggest that that whole exercise we went through was actually our way of walking through an algorithm. So here's a particular algorithm that follows from what we just did. Let me just write that down for you. All right, so here's the algorithm, Michael. So it's very simple. For each H in H, that is, each candidate hypothesis in our hypothesis space, simply calculate the probability of that hypothesis given the data, which we know is equal to the probability of the data given that hypothesis, times the prior probability of the hypothesis divided by the probability of the data, and then simply output whichever hypothesis has maximal probability. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So I do want to point out that since all we care about is computing the argmax, as before, we don't ever have to actually compute that little bit. So that's a good thing because we don't always know what the prior probability on the data is. So we can ignore it for the purposes of finding the maximal hypothesis.
So the place you removed it from, it seems like that's not actually valid because it's not the case that the probability of H given D equals the probability of D given H times the probability of H. It just means that we don't care what the value of it is when we go to compute the argmax.
That's right. So in fact, it's probably better to say that I'm going to approximate the probability of the hypothesis given the data by just calculating the probability of the data given the hypothesis times the probability of the hypothesis and just go ahead and ignore the denominator. Precisely because it doesn't change the maximal H.
Yeah, so it's nice that that goes away.
Right, because it's hard to know often what the prior probability over the data is.
It would be nice if we didn't have to worry about the other one either.
Which other one?
The probability of H. Where is that coming from?
Ah, right. So where does that come from? So that's a deep philosophical question. Sometimes it's just simply something you believe and you can write down. And sometimes it's a little harder. And that's actually good that you bring that up. When we compute our probabilities this way, so it's actually got a name. It's the MAP, or the maximum a posteriori hypothesis. And that makes sense. It's the biggest posterior given all of your priors. But you're right, Michael, that often it's just as hard to say anything particular about your prior over the hypotheses as it is to say something about your prior over the data. And so it is very common to drop that. And in dropping that, we're actually computing the argmax over the probability of the data given the hypothesis. And that is known as the maximum likelihood hypothesis.
I guess you can't call it the maximum a priori hypothesis because then it would also be MAP.
Exactly. Although I've never thought about that before. By the way, just to be clear, we're not really dropping this in this case. What we really said is that our prior belief is that all hypotheses are equally likely. So we have a uniform prior. That is, the probability of any given hypothesis is exactly the same as the probability of any other given hypothesis.
I see. So you're saying if we assume that they all are equally likely, then the choice of hypothesis doesn't change that term at all, the P of H term, so it really is equivalent to just ignoring it.
Exactly. It's some constant. We don't even have to know what the constant is. But whatever it is, it's the same everywhere, and therefore it doesn't affect the other terms, or in particular affect the argmax computation. So that's actually pretty cool, right? But I want you to think about what we just did. We just took something that was very hard, computing the probability of a hypothesis given the data, and turned it into something that's much easier, that is, computing the probability of you seeing the data labels given a particular hypothesis. And it turns out that those are effectively the same thing if you don't have a strong prior. So that's really cool. So we're done, right? We now know how to find the best hypothesis. You're just finding the most likely hypothesis or the most probable one, and that turns out to be the same thing as just simply finding the hypothesis that best matches the data. We're done. It's easy. Everything's
over. The math seems very nice and pretty and easy, but isn't it hiding like a lot of work to actually do these computations?
Well, sure. Well, look, you know how to do multiplication. That's pretty easy, right? So I guess yeah. The only hard part is we have to look at every single hypothesis.
Yeah, that's just a slight little, issue.
So mathematically meaningful, but computationally questionable.
Mm.
So the big point there is that it's not practical. Well, unless the number of hypotheses is really, really small. But as we know, a lot of the hypothesis spaces that we care about, like, for example, linear separators, are actually infinite. And so it's going to be very difficult to use this algorithm directly. But despite all that, I think that there's still something important that we get out of thinking about it this way. In just the same way that we get something important out of thinking about VC dimension, even if we're not entirely sure how to compute it in some particular case. This really gives us a gold standard, right? We have an algorithm, at least a conceptual algorithm, that tells us what the right thing to do would be if we were capable of computing it directly. So that's good because we can maybe prove things about this and compare results that we get from some real live algorithm to what we might expect to get. But also it turns out it's pretty cute because it helps us to say other things about what it is we actually expect to learn. And I'm going to give you a couple examples of those just to sort of prove my point. Sound good?
Yeah.
Okay.